Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 13759 in the name of Gillian Martin on Scottish Government priorities tackling the climate emergency. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate, please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Minister Gillian Martin to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has confirmed that tackling the climate crisis is one of his top priorities for the Government, alongside eradicating child poverty, growing the economy and improving public services. And that commitment to climate change, both here and internationally, has long been at the heart of this Government. Indeed, in Scotland, we're among the first to take bold, early action, and we continue to lead globally in responding to the climate emergency. The twin crisis of climate change and biodiversity loss are clearly with us now, and tackling them is the collective fight of all of us in our lifetime, given that they are perhaps the single greatest long-term threat that we face globally. The motion today calls on this chamber to recommit itself to the undeniable imperative for action. The science and evidence is not only clear about the scale and the urgency of climate change, but the importance of being part of international action as well as pushing forward domestically. Our domestic and international aspirations come together in an unwavering commitment to reach net zero emissions by 2045. That's both 5 years ahead of the UK and still one of the most ambitious targets in the world. But a just transition to net zero by 2045 will require genuine transformational action and investment across our economy and society, with significant changes in sectors such as energy, heat, buildings, transport and agriculture. And just as this Parliament set that high ambition for 2045, it's essential that we come together to reaffirm that ambition and the action needed to meet that ambition. All too often it's been the case that with modest measures the Scottish Government has brought forward not been supported, and I hope that this can be a point at which to reset, because we do need action, not just talk. I want to talk about our role in addressing the global challenge of climate change. In 2012, we were the first government to establish a climate justice fund, solely committed to supporting the most climate vulnerable communities in the global south, to build resilience to the unavoidable impacts of climate change. We were the first Global North government to commit finance explicitly to addressing loss and damage, and have helped to galvanise global ambition with over $750 million now committed worldwide. Recent programmes have included support for the urban dimension of loss and damage, supporting households in Malawi following the devastation of Tropical Storm Freddy, and piloting an innovative approach across a loss and damage window with Scotland's Humanitarian Emergency Fund. Those have not only been projects critical to supporting those countries, but actions focused on helping individuals and communities with the impact of climate change, a hallmark of our approach domestically as well as internationally. And as European co-chair of the European Under 2 Coalition, we've driven international cooperation to further collective climate action. I'm also very pleased to announce today that Scotland will be taking over the presidency of the Regions for Development Network, a network of states, regions and devolved governments focusing on tackling the twin crisis of climate and biodiversity and advancing sustainable development. Our international role is rooted in what we have done domestically and where we can point to real progress. We are now exactly halfway to net zero, with Scotland achieving its largest reduction in emissions of any nature in the UK between 1990 and 2022, and we've decarbonised faster than the average of the EU 27 countries. That's reflected in the action we're taking. For example, we have the most comprehensive network of electric vehicle public charging points per head of population in the UK outside of London. We're now supporting low emission zones to bring clean air to Scotland's cities and help protect public health. We have some of the most generous grants and loans in the UK to encourage the switch to cleaner forms of heating and to make energy efficiency improvements. And this I will do.
Sarah Boyack.
It's actually not possible to get solar panel funding in Scotland, and it still is south of the border. So it's not the most generous system, and actually we need to do way more to encourage and support people to decarbonise their homes. Don't you agree?
Through the chair, please, Minister.
Ms Boyack and I have had an exchange on this very point just very recently about why we are actually focusing the funding that we do have available to us to actually encouraging the switch from actual emitting and polluting heating systems. That could mean the switch between a gas boiler and a heat pump. And we have had to make some tough decisions with regard to where we focus that money. Now, however, if there's a new UK government comes in that wants to give us more by way of consequentials in this area, we would relook at that policy. More than 75% of all tree planting in the UK in recent years has been in Scotland. And the Circular Economy Bill, which will shortly complete its parliamentary process. I will in a second. The Circular Economy Bill, which will shortly complete its parliamentary process, will support Scotland's transition to a zero waste and circular economy, significantly increasing reuse and recycling rates, modernise and improve waste and recycling services, and build on a range of transformational measures we're already putting in place, including banning problematic single-use plastic items, reforming extended producer responsibility for packaging, and our ongoing £70 million investment in local authority recycling infrastructure.
Edward Mountain.
And I thank the Minister for giving way on that point. I had to intervene on the issue of tree planting. Of course, we've hardly met our tree planting targets in the last 6 years. I think we're about 20,000 hectares behind of where we should be. And this year we put through 10 million trees on the scrap heap because we cut the planting grants. Is the government proud of that, or are they just going to say we're planting more trees but ignoring the fact that they can't reach their targets and are scrapping trees?
Minister.
Key to us delivering on the ambitious targets that we put in place is having the capital funding that allows us to fund all those programmes. I said that to Ms Boyack. I'm saying that to Mr Mountain as well. If we want to be a front runner in all these areas, we have to understand that they have to be funded. And when you have cuts to your capital budget or you have inflationary rises that you did not have any hand in, it is very difficult to meet those commitments. Now, you'll notice in my speech that I make the point there has to be investment and funding against all of these actions. Our commitment to net zero will help boost our economic... I've taken too many interventions already. Scotland's economy grew by 67% in real terms between 1990 and 2022, at the same time as we cut our greenhouse gas emissions in half, demonstrating that tackling climate change and growing our economy absolutely go hand in hand. We want to combine Scotland's vibrant entrepreneurial nation, world-leading academic and research institution, valuable natural resources, and our businesses and communities in a shared agenda to deliver net zero. And as part of this, we will help businesses and investors through development and delivery of our green industrial strategy, so that the people of Scotland can share in the enormous economic opportunities of the global transition to net zero. One of the key areas in which we're seizing these opportunities is in our vision for Scotland to become a renewables powerhouse that the people of Scotland see the benefit from. In 2022, 87.9% of electricity generation came from zero or low carbon sources. This has already brought huge benefits to Scotland in terms of economic growth, export opportunities, and well-paid skilled jobs. And that was evidenced by the recent significant investments by Sumitomo at NIG and Haventus at Ardersier. ScotWind is absolutely central to this ambition. As the world's largest commercial round for floating offshore wind, it's put Scotland at the forefront of offshore wind development globally. We see huge potential for Scotland in hydrogen production as well. There's a great demand for green hydrogen, and Scotland is very well placed to develop a significant hydrogen sector, which will create many jobs and income for the nation as a whole, whether using hydrogen domestically or exporting it to other countries. And similarly, our approach to net zero will also ensure support for our commitment to ending child poverty. For example, if you look at our policy of making public transport more accessible and affordable, it's a key part of this approach. And our Scotland wide bus schemes offer free travel to a larger percentage of the population than anywhere else in the UK. And our ScotRail's peak fares removal pilot is a first in the UK. I'll take Mr Rowley.
Alec Rowley.
Certainly the lower fares or free fares for under 22s is welcomed. But the reality is you can have a bus pass, but if you can't get a bus... And our bus services in a lot of communities is in utter chaos. So do you accept we need to actually look at the total bus provision?
Through the chair, please, Minister.
There's been hundreds of millions of pounds put into the bus network. However, as a rural MSP, I absolutely recognise it's perhaps actually in constituencies like mine where we have a situation long after the deregulation of bus services that there has been certainly a lot of action needed from successive governments in putting more investment into particularly rural networks, and that's what we're committed to do. We also have a range of policy interventions which are designed to decrease fuel poverty, and we continue to press for reform in the reserved areas that affect this at source. And moreover, the just transition plans are in development for transport, agriculture and land reform, buildings and construction, as well as the site-specific plan for Grangemouth, demonstrating this commitment and action. We're also strengthening Scotland's resilience to the impacts of climate change, and we'll set out how we're doing this with the publication of our Scottish National Adaptation Plan later this year, and are consulting on a new national flood resilience strategy right now. Given the constraints of devolution, we cannot do this alone. Scotland lacks the full range of levers to deal with the long-term challenges in the way that others can. But we also want to make the point that the UK needs to invest significantly in climate action if both Scotland and the UK are to meet both their targets on net zero. One of us can't do it without the other. The impact of the UK government's former UK government's completely wrong-headed real-terms cut to Scotland's capital funding of almost 9% over 5 years is having an impact on what we do.
Minister,
and we've heard
could you
about
please bring
today.
Your remarks to close, please?
I will close my remarks. Presiding Officer, I hope that Parliament recognises the urgency of tackling the twin crisis of climate change and biodiversity loss as the science and the imperative to be part of global action demands. The Government remains fully committed to rising to the challenge, reaping the economic benefits of a just and fair transition to net zero. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Minister. I now call Douglas Lumsden to speak to and move Amendment 137.59.3. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I must admit I'm a bit perplexed today as to why the SNP have decided to bring a debate to the Chamber on the subject of the climate emergency when they have failed so dismally to meet their own climate targets and obligations.
Yeah.
Only 6 days ago, it was revealed that another target has been missed, bringing the grand total of 9 failures out of 13 targets. Mm-hmm. And this devolved SNP government is asking the public to judge them on their record. And that record is one of failure, over-promising, under-delivering, and an abandonment of industries in the North East. To come to the Chamber today lauding the so-called achievements is complete nonsense. Yep. And I have no idea how the Minister can say these things with a straight face. I'll take an intervention.
Minister.
Would he call £500 million of investment in the supply chain for ScotWind and £500 million investment in a just transition plan abandonment of the North East?
Douglas Lumsden.
You can look at how much the budget was cut for the Just Transition Fund this year. I think it was 75%. And let me get back to the Climate Change Committee report that was published in March and remind the government what the conclusions of the committee were. In March, they reported that the Scottish Government was failing to achieve Scotland's climate goals. Emissions targets have been repeatedly missed, and the publication of Scotland's draft climate change plan has been delayed again. And still no sign of the plan. So when will we see it? I will take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary Mara McCallum.
Grateful to Douglas Lumsden for taking an intervention. I am proud of the progress that we've made, but clearly the targets have been missed. I wonder what contribution he would attribute to those targets having been missed to his party's position on low emission zones, on workplace parking, or indeed his colleagues in the Scotland office completely bringing deposit return scheme to an end.
Douglas Lumsden.
Well, once again, we see the government taking no responsibility because, as far as I'm aware, the Conservative Party haven't blocked anything that's coming through this Parliament. The only people blocking issues is the Greens and the SNP that we've seen yesterday, blocking where we wanted to have recycling targets put back in place. So all of those questions should be the focus of the government's remarks today, not some false patting on the back for the great achievement of missing targets and failing in their obligations on climate change. The committee also noted that the policy and plans that the government had in place would not be enough to achieve the legal targets required on the Climate Change Act, and there were significant areas of concern, particularly around those devolved areas of competencies, such as buildings, transport agriculture, land use and waste. But yet again, rather than coming forward with a clear plan of how we can move forward, this devolved SNP government are coming forward with platitudes and promises. If we are to meet our obligations, we need a clear plan. A clear plan that works with communities and industries to meet our climate obligations with achievable and measurable targets. But we also need a government that will take this forward and deliver a true just transition for everyone in Scotland as we move towards more renewable energy sources. But we have no plan here in Scotland. I'll give way.
Ruskell. Delighted to hear the member talk about renewable energy and the need to invest. Would he acknowledge that building out the transmission infrastructure required in the North East to get the renewable energy from where it's being generated to where it needs to be consumed is absolutely critical? Why does this party not back the development of the SSEN transmission lines that are so desperately needed?
Douglas Lomden.
Because the infrastructure will have to be done with communities and not to communities, not roughshod over them. There needs to be proper consultation, and that is not happening with the communities I talk to. This SNP government also committed to publishing a route map for the delivery of around 25,000 electric vehicle charging points by 2030. Yet here we are, halfway through 2024, with no indication of how this will be achieved. To meet this target, the government will have to install 384 points per month from now until the end of 2029. Does anyone in this chamber believe that that is going to happen? No. We need a plan. No. The devolved government also stated that it will decarbonise our railway by 2035. It sounds great, but there is no plan. When I ask when the 50-year-old diesel Intercity 125s will be replaced, I don't get an answer. When I ask if the East Coast Main Line between Aberdeen and the Central Beltway will be electrified, I get no answer. When I ask when the promised £200 million to reduce journey times between Aberdeen and the Central Belt by 20 minutes, which is meant to happen by 2026, I don't get an answer. So many broken promises by the SNP government, and that's why they simply cannot be trusted anymore. Now, given the failure to meet 9 of the current 13 targets, you will forgive our scepticism. But that scepticism is well placed. Audit Scotland has said that the climate change governance arrangements are missing core elements. They are facing legal challenge for the mismanagement of the introduction of the deposit return scheme. They are missing 4 of the 6 recycling targets. And the bill that will be completed today will do very little to increase those rates. Yeah. The Scottish Conservatives brought forward sensible amendments to drive up recycling rates, but each one was knocked back by the SNP and the so-called Greens. Yeah. I'll give way to the Minister.
Minister.
I'd be really interested to know what Douglas Lumsden's plan is for transformational change and decarbonising Scotland's sectors, given that he has said that we are failing in this. What would he do that is different with regard to, for example, the electricity infrastructure that Mark Ruskell mentioned?
Douglas Lumsden, give
you the
time back.
Electricity infrastructure, I've already said it would be working with communities to put an infrastructure in place that works for those communities. There is no climate change plan from this government. That is quite clear. It was meant to be here over a year ago, but got no sign of it whatsoever. No idea when it's going to be here. Presiding officer, it's vitally important that in our deliberations and decision-making around climate change, that we listen to experts and follow the science. We know that nuclear is a viable, safe and desirable alternative to carbon-based fuels, and yet this government has discounted it without looking at the science. Scotland is at risk of being left behind globally in the move to smaller, more locally based nuclear power. This government should look again at this issue and listen to our science and experts in this field. The contribution of nuclear to our energy mix is a vital one and is currently being run down with no plans to replace. This must be looked at again to ensure that we have stable energy mix. Is there time for more interventions?
I can give you a bit more time, yeah.
Okay.
Claire Haughey.
Thank you very much. Can I thank Douglas Lumsden for allowing my intervention? Is Mr Lumsden therefore offering up his region as a site for a new nuclear power plant? Has he consulted his constituents about that?
Douglas Lumsden.
We can't do anything because this SNP government won't allow anything. But if you look at where we've had nuclear power plants in the past, those communities are actually in favour of that. But let me now turn to the oil and gas sector. Presiding officer, we have had so many debates on this topic in the last 6 months. It's an important topic when you remember that thousands of jobs associated with industry in the North East and beyond. We know that oil and gas will remain a key part of our energy mix for some time to come. We all agree that we should be moving away from carbon-based fuels and towards renewables. But we cannot turn our back on the industry and leave them with a cliff edge, as proposed by this devolved SNP government. Yep. Importing oil and gas from abroad is more expensive, more detrimental to the environment. Production of natural gas from the UK continental shelf creates less than half as much greenhouse gases as imported LNG. While there's still a need for oil and gas, we should be working with industry in the North East to produce it here and support those businesses and jobs moving forward. There should be no presumption against new licences, but that is the damaging policy of the SNP. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this SNP government have a brass neck coming to this chamber today to talk about climate change. They are standing on a funeral pyre of failed promises when it comes to climate targets. 9 out of 13 missed so far. No clear plan to meet targets. No published climate change plan. No indication of when that plan might be published. No plan on EV infrastructure rollout. No clear plan on decarbonising our railway. The Scottish Conservatives are the only party who are offering Scotland a just transition and a clear plan towards our climate change goals. And I'm pleased to move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Lunsden. I now call on Sarah Boyett to speak to move amendment 13759.2, around 6 minutes. Ms. Boyett.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. We've now passed two climate change acts in Scotland, 2009 and 2019, and there was cross-party support for both those pieces of legislation. But the SNP government has failed 9 out of the 13 annual targets set, so the need to act has never been more important. And I actually thought today the purpose of this debate would be to actually try and bring people together, but we didn't hear what concrete plan the Scottish Government want to put in place to address the climate emergency. And we need more than warm words, not delayed strategy after delayed strategy, but real action, because it's the action that's been missing, not the ambition. And the SNP keeps saying that the now abandoned 2030 targets were always unachievable. But when they were first introduced, the UK Committee on Climate Change wrote to the Scottish Government, listed the areas where they could take direct, immediate action if they wanted to achieve those ambitious targets which Labour supported. And that hasn't happened. And many of the recent... Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Sarah Boyack, for taking that intervention. She is absolutely right to talk about the deliberations that took place prior to the passing of the previous Act, but I would quote to her the CCC's advice following passage of the bill, where they stated, "We find that the legislated 2030 target of a 75% reduction in Scottish emissions goes beyond any of our five scenarios for emissions reduction by that date." They did go on and set out some potential options, which was embedded in CCS. Does she regret, as I do, that the UK Government have failed to deploy CCUS in the time since the bill?
The point was, every time the UK CCC comments on the climate targets, they come up with practical solutions that have not been followed. It's not just the carbon capture stuff, it's the work at Grangemouth. There was a raft of issues that could have been taken then and haven't been taken. And that, I think, is my frustration, because from 2009, there's been a lot more that could have been done. A lot of the ideas that Scottish Labour would support are actually policies that would be practical, that could be done, and the SNP talk about but haven't actually delivered. Reducing car kilometres, decarbonising domestic heating, restoring biodiversity through sustainable land use. Those are pragmatic things that can be done, and crucially, the transition to renewable energy. When I set the targets in the first Parliament, they were seen as radical, but we've come far along the track, but there's so much more that we need to do. And I really honestly thought we were going to hear more about what was going to happen in terms of action and delivery. And the last UK Climate Change Committee report criticised that lack of action, because it's not enough just to claim you'll reduce car kilometres by 20%. How would you do it? At our recent CPG and Sustainable Transport Poverty Inquiry, the message came through loud and clear that we need affordable, reliable and accessible rail and bus services for people that are able to use them, particularly in rural areas, but right across the country. And people don't have the opportunity to use their bus bus passes. It's simply not possible if there are no routes, and we need to keep seeing more active travel routes that are safe. So simply exploring ideas, for example, the integrated transport ticketing system, an idea from 2012, won't cut it. And if you look right across every sector, you can see the same story. I mentioned decarbonising heat. It's vital and necessary. But the Minister's answer to me on solar just fundamentally misunderstands. The transition people want to make needs to be supported. And for example, the SNP government failed to deliver the £133 million they had budgeted to retrofit people's homes. And that would have transformed people's fuel poverty. Yes, of course.
Minister. Brief.
A scenario where there is a limited budget. Is it better to focus that budget on decarbonising homes, home heating? Or is it better to spread that amongst other technologies and not have the same impact?
I'm right back in that, because the people that have written to me were first of all going to install solar panels to bring their electricity bill down, then they were going to do heat pumps, and now they're going to do neither, because the first bit was reducing their electricity bills, because it's a joined up approach that you need to have if you're a householder, because not everybody's got access to cheap fuel. So it's a key issue, and the Scottish Government, I thought the Minister would come in on the £133 million they'd failed to spend, but no. No, that was budgeted and not spent. We need to support our community. No, thank you. You keep interrupting. We need firm action. The climate emergency is not a future problem. It's a now issue. It's already damaging our rail and roads infrastructure, forcing people out of their homes. We cannot afford another summer of wildfires in southern Europe or the 1,300 people who tragically died from extreme heat in Saudi Arabia just weeks ago. The climate emergency is a now issue. So I'm very delighted that the SNP likes so many of Labour's ideas, that they've adopted them wholesale in the recent election promises. I just thought the First Minister might have been here to tell us what he's going to do, but sadly not. We had announced many of those issues days before, but I go back to my point, words are not enough. You need to do things. In 2017, the SNP government pledged to set up a publicly owned energy company. Of course, it's never happened. But now we've got a real opportunity to build on our renewable success with Labour's plan for GB Energy HQ'd in Scotland to bring down bills for Scottish people, provide energy security and ramp up our progress to net zero. Ministers regularly say, oh, we're keen to work with the incoming Westminster government to ensure we collaborate across the United Kingdom. That needs to happen now, because it is not acceptable just to always blame the Tory government. Now, I blame them for a lot, but a lot of what they're blamed for are actually SNP failures of government. The status quo isn't enough. This Parliament needs to start with a publication of a new climate bill, followed by immediate publication of the climate change plan. It's been talked about for weeks now. We still have no information. Let's get on with the change we need. Current inaction is not good enough. The Scottish Parliament has powers to make positive changes and to become true world leaders, not just world talkers in this area. But we need the immediate action to make that a reality. Let's get on with it.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. I now call on Patrick Harvey to speak to and move Amendment 137.59.1 around 4 minutes. Mr Harvey.
Presiding Officer, 15 years ago, Scotland set legally binding climate targets. The goal was to achieve a step change in emission cuts and to become a world leader on climate policy. But in truth, Scotland's emissions were slowly coming down before the Act, and they continued on pretty much the same trajectory. Apart from renewable electricity, pretty much every other sector we've seen emissions broadly flatlining or reducing so modestly that it made very little difference. How we use energy, as well as transport policy, land use policy and more, should have seen ambitious policy change to drive down emissions from other sectors. It didn't happen. And as a result of that, Scotland is now years behind where we should be. While we'll support the Labour amendment, I do think it's questionable to refer to consistent cross-party support for ambitious action, because in fact cross-party support has often been lacking for the policy change that's needed, because road traffic emissions will not come down without price playing its part in demand management. Land use emissions will not come down without fundamental changes to what food we produce and how we subsidise it. Heating emissions will not come down without an ambitious programme to get us off the gas grid and face down the lobbyists for the status quo, as well as those in this chamber who have seemed determined to water down the heat in buildings programme. We're also being held back, presiding officer, by the false but prevalent idea that the market must lead the transition, or indeed that the fossil fuel industry itself should be allowed to determine the timescale for action. Let's be clear about the fossil fuel industry's track record. They've known about the harm they were doing since the 1950s. There were decades of cover-up, followed by decades of deliberate propaganda to create a climate denial conspiracy movement. Nowadays, most oil and gas companies have moved away from denial toward delay. We need a transition, but please make it slower. It's like Augustine's prayer, Lord, grant me chastity, but please, Lord, not yet. There was a time when the world could have made this transition slowly. That time was decades ago. We're long past that point now. By most estimates, around two-thirds of oil and gas reserves must stay in the ground. That means investment in fossil fuel supply must decline dramatically now and in the years ahead. But what are the fossil fuel giants doing now? Well, they've generated truly vast profits. BP profits were nearly $28 billion in 2022, nearly $14 billion the year after. Shell raked in $40 billion and $28 billion in the same years. Yet both companies' investment in clean energy has flatlined, and both have doubled down on new fossil fuel investment. If there's time, I'll take one intervention.
Give the time back. Monica Lennon.
Yeah, very briefly, because the Member's making some really important points, but we are here to talk about action that this government can take in Scotland. Does he agree with me and many others that the Scottish Government should join the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance quickly?
Patrick Harvey.
It's something the Greens have advocated for persistently, and we continue to do so. The International Energy Agency has stated, for the moment, the oil and gas industry as a whole is a marginal force in the world's transition to a clean energy system. In fact, that industry accounts for only 1% of global clean energy investment. Presiding officer, it is no longer just the Greens and the climate movement who are calling out the fossil fuel industry for its dishonesty and for the harm that it continues to do. As well as the International Energy Agency, the UN Secretary General and a host of other authoritative global voices have been clear. And as for a new climate bill here in Scotland, I have to say that if it is seen as just a technical fix to get the government out of a legal hole, then I fear that the second half of this journey will be just as sluggish as the first, and we will fail. Instead, this bill must be seen as a pivotal moment, locking in the bold policy changes that are needed to get us back on track and get to net zero by 2045. We still have time, but only just. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Harvey. We now move to the opening debate. I call first Rona Mackay to be followed by Maurice Golden, around 4 minutes. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's no doubt that we are discussing one of the most important issues facing all of us in society today. Global climate change is moving at an alarming rate, and if it isn't addressed now, it will have a catastrophic effect on future generations. In reality, we have globally, collectively, hidden our heads in the sand over what's happening, and we're really now running to catch up. That's why I'm pleased that the Scottish Government is committed to a green future and is investing in growing the green economy to deliver a world-leading just transition to net zero. Action to address the scale and pace of the emergency is an environmental imperative, a moral necessity, an economic opportunity and a top priority for the Scottish Government. But, Presiding Officer, the problem is that both Labour and the Tories are backtracking on serious climate policy and investment, jeopardising the just transition and the race to net zero. And that's a shame for everyone, because this issue should really be above political point scoring. Scotland's First Minister has said fighting the climate crisis can't be allowed to descend into a typical political fight, making clear that it demands unity and consensus across our politics. He's set out plans for an annual £28 billion green investment to grow the economy, protect jobs and invest in the domestic supply chain. Scotland was one of the first countries to declare a climate emergency, and our net zero target is among the world's most ambitious. However, if the UK Government could at least match the £500 million North East Transition Fund being delivered by the Scottish Government, this would be a huge step forward. As with the speedy deployment of the ACORN project and the Scottish Cluster for Carbon Capture, Utilisation and Storage, absolutely crucial. No, I won't, thank you. I agree with the section in the Green Motion that quotes the UN Secretary-General's description of fossil fuel companies as the godfathers of climate chaos. We must move away from them, and quickly. A just transition for Grangemouth is imperative, and plans are underway for its workers to be upskilled to deliver new green industries to secure the site for the long term. We need to take an evidence-based approach to oil and gas through robust climate compatibility assessments before issuing any new coal licences. Presiding Officer, the Tory preference for nuclear... No, thank you. Presiding Officer, the Tory preference for nuclear energy is simply a non-starter. Scotland has an abundance of renewable power due to its amazing natural resources, and as a small nation, we are now realising their benefits. Scotland, a nation of barely 6 million people, generates enough electricity for 25 million citizens every day, which is transferred to England and sold back to Scottish consumers, who are then charged the highest prices in Europe to use their own energy. In what world is that fair or even sensible? Keir Starmer, if he becomes the next Prime Minister, as looks likely, should really step up and recommit to his previous £28 billion green investment, disgracefully scrapped to achieve net zero. Presiding Officer, this is the biggest issue facing every generation on this planet for decades, if not centuries to come. Everybody knows that. Scotland has shown early and sustained leadership in meeting our climate responsibilities, but we could make a much greater contribution to global climate action were we not reliant on poor decisions made by the UK Government and if we were able to work together and have the support that we need. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Maurice Golden to be followed by Ben McPherson in around 4 minutes. Mr Golden.
Presiding Officer, let me start by welcoming the news last week that Scotland's emissions are now more than 50% below their 1990 level. It's important we celebrate success because it shows that the public, climate action works, and they need to see if they are to have the trust in climate policies being set out on their behalf. But when climate policy fails, there needs to be honesty. The public need to understand what has gone wrong, who is taking responsibility, and what will be done to get things back on track. If not, then ministers risk destroying the public's trust in climate action, and when the trust goes, so does our ability to take big decisions needed to get us to net zero by 2045. So, it's extremely worrying to see the SNP government continuing to resort to excuses, spin, and outright political attacks in order to disguise their failures. Let me be clear, the responsibility lies with the Scottish government. Just last week, the SNP confirmed they had missed their annual emissions target again, the ninth time out of the past 13 for anyone still keeping count. Not that we will be able to keep counting, as the SNP, rather than trying to meet the targets, they are scrapping them instead. I suggested the repeated failure and attempt to blame others risked eroding public trust in climate action earlier in this chamber. I even suggested an independent environmental court to improve accountability without more party politics. In response, I heard a tirade about the Prime Minister, English coal mines and recycling bins. Wow. This inability to acknowledge their shortcomings, to accept they don't have all the answers, and to listen to advice has become the hallmark of this SNP government. Now, it would be easy for me to stand here and list their mounting environmental failures. So I shall. As we have heard, the SNP have missed their legally binding emissions targets 9 out of the past 13 times, but they've also abandoned the critical 2030 net zero target. They've delayed the next climate change plan. They've been referred to the Environmental Standards Scotland for breaching the Climate Change Act. They've missed their renewable heat target. They've missed the majority of their international biodiversity targets. They've not kept the promise to restore 20,000 hectares of peatland each year. They've overseen a decline in commuting by public transport. They've missed their active travel target for bike journeys. I'm just listing your failures. Sorry, Deputy Presiding Officer. Just listing the Scottish Government's failures, and then I'm happy to bring the Minister in. They've still not managed to deliver their 2013 household recycling target. They've failed to recycle more than 5% of their own plastic waste in Scotland. They've turned a widely supported deposit return scheme into a rolling disaster. They've admitted their food waste target is likely to fail. They've failed to introduce a landfill ban as promised in 2021. And they've turned Scotland into the ashtray of Europe with municipal incineration capacity up sevenfold. Happy to give way.
Very, very briefly, Minister.
It's a very brief point. A list of targets is one thing. But with Maurice Golden, the spirit of actually working together to achieve on goals to get to net zero, recognise that we need more investment in the action. And that is only going to come if the UK government puts a similar amount of priority on reaching net zero that this Parliament has.
And you need to be winding up, Mr Golden.
Thank you. I think the Scottish Government's proven track record of failure proves that money isn't the problem. It's the policy makers themselves. And that's why we need to, as a Parliament, get together and ensure that we were tackling this climate emergency, because the Scottish Government certainly don't appear to be caring about that.
Thank you. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Monica Lennon. Around 4 minutes, Mr McPherson.
The seriousness of the global climate emergency is so difficult, it can often be overwhelming and demoralising when trying to think about doing something about it. But if we continue collectively to think global and act local, we can make a meaningful difference, as years past have shown. I am of the firm view that together we can only make progress on this issue if there is a positive discussion. Yes, realistic. Yes, honest. Yes, practical. But we must be positive, and we must think, if we all care about this issue, as this Parliament has committed to on several occasions, then what can we do where we share the same objective and want to work collectively for the benefit of our constituents? In this Parliament, we hear evidence all the time from experts. Sometimes it really sticks with you when you hear somebody at a committee or another forum. And on the 23rd of April this year, at the NZEC committee, Chris Stark made his last appearance as chair of the Climate Change Committee. That evidence was extremely compelling, and I'd like to repeat a number of the things he said that day. One of the key points he made was this. He said, the benefits to this country of achieving net zero are immense. Not just to the climate, but in the form of jobs, to the landscape around us, to trade, and to a host of social issues. Those reasons, alongside the climate benefits, are why we should want to pursue net zero. The transition is good for the climate, good for the economy, and good for the people living in this country. For me and my constituency, this applies in a number of different ways. Every week and every day, from Nova Innovation taking forward some of the most remarkable tidal technology in the world and growing as a business, to the recent announcement that Vestas, a world-leading blade maker, has begun the process of securing planning permission for a site at Leith Docks in Edinburgh, creating new jobs and making a huge contribution, particularly notable during this week of wind energy, towards the remarkable contribution that we can make to wind energy from Scotland as a benefit for us and elsewhere. Low emission zones are already making a difference, and I think that's important. When we had Clean Air Day last week, and it was reminded to us all as a society that there are 1,700 premature deaths due to pollution, and that it is the leading cause of preventable ill health in Scotland. All these things are a reason for net zero, as well as tackling the climate emergency. And I go back to the words of Chris Stark. He said, I'm increasingly of the view that if we are going to get to net zero by 2045, we probably will not do so by making arguments solely on a climate basis. For example, it is jobs in Falkirk that should drive the investments to decarbonise Grangemouth. And the fact that that also helps the climate should be a secondary reinforcing concern. Similarly, the fact that we are making homes warmer and reducing energy bills is the reason why we want to make the investment in buildings. And the fact that it helps the climate is a reinforcing aspect. I'm happy for net zero to step into that reinforcing secondary role. We still have to get to net zero. It's very important that we do that. But we have been through quite an odd period, frankly, where the primary reason for a lot of what we've been doing was net zero alone. And that is a strategy that probably does not have that much longer to run. The benefits of net zero are widespread. I'm very pleased that the government remains so committed to delivering on that and all its benefits and achieving net zero by 2045.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Stuart McMillan, around 4 minutes. Ms.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I take the opportunity to extend my best wishes to the Cabinet Secretary as she's about to embark on maternity leave, and I look forward to continuing to work with Ms Martin and, of course, Dr Allen when he takes up his post. As the motion rightly asks Parliament, we should reaffirm our collective commitment to tackling the twin crises of climate change and biodiversity loss through a just and fair transition. Very few people in Scotland would disagree. We've had really helpful briefings, including from Stop Climate Chaos Scotland, Scottish Land and Estates, Uplift and Scottish Rewilding Alliance. Tackling climate emergency is an era-defining challenge, and all politicians and all governments have a moral responsibility to act. We can't slow down or lose courage. But as other colleagues have said today, and I think as the government recognises itself, the government has been struggling to turn ambition into action. We've heard about the government's failure to meet legal targets, and that is really important. Sarah Boyack set out at the beginning that we must see the new climate bill from the government. We can't have any more delay. We need a climate change plan at the back of that. But just if I can quote Dr. Shivali Fifield from the Environmental Rights Centre for Scotland, because she says, quote, to the government we say, show us your homework. Too many times you have overpromised and under-delivered. And in a climate emergency, the stakes are too high for wishful thinking, end quotes. We agree the failure to meet targets is not the only case of the government failing. We've heard many say, including the Climate Change Committee, we've seen an absence of climate policy. And I agree with Transform Scotland that the Scottish Government's commitment to cut car kilometres by 20% by 2030 is to be commended. But we are now 3 years on from that commitment with no real plan in place. And that isn't good enough. So I hope we will have a real answer on when the route map to reduce car kilometres by 20% will be published and what policy measures it will contain. Of course.
Briefly, Minister.
Would Monica Lennon recognise the significance of one of the most significant actions about the ScotWind auction round being the largest of its type in the world? That is the Scottish Government, the Crown Estate, that have done that. It's going to be a significant step in decarbonising our energy supply, not just for Scotland, but for the whole of the UK.
Monica Lennon.
Well, I was talking about transport, but on ScotWind, what I do hear is a concern that Scotland's seabed has been sold off far too cheaply. But I think we can have another debate about that. But back to transport, because what additional policies will be introduced to support the expansion of train, tram and bus services? I might steal some of Graeme Simpson's lines, but when we've discussed it at the Net Zero Committee, we've heard real concern about bus deserts, areas where people, yes, young and old, have a free bus pass, but there is no bus to get on. And we've seen across the country, including in Lanarkshire right now, affecting my constituents, and more councils cutting back on school transport because they don't have the budget. So we need the government to get real on that. I agree with Uplift and their call regarding workforce. To achieve a just transition, the government needs to urgently deliver a coherent transition plan for workers, or we will risk situations like we're seeing in Grangemouth right now occurring around the country. If I can bring my remarks to a close, I just want to quote Lord Deben, the outgoing chair of the Climate Change Committee. He said, "Our children will not forgive us if we leave them a world of withering heat and devastating storms, where sea levels rise and extreme temperatures force millions to move because our countries are no longer habitable. None of us can avoid our responsibility. Delay is not an option." I agree, and Scottish Labour stand ready to work with the Scottish Government where necessary, and we will push them to be bolder at all times.
Thank you. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Edward Mount in around 4 minutes. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Representative Officer. First of all, I welcome the Scottish Government reaffirming its commitment to tackling the twin crisis of climate change and biodiversity loss, because all too often, tackling climate change is seen as something governments can concern themselves with when things are all rosy, when the finances are in abundance and when life feels easy. However, we cannot afford to think like that, as the impact of the climate emergency is exacerbating existing inequalities for people all over the world, but especially for those who have not contributed to climate change. Now, Scotland has continually shown early and sustained leadership in meeting our climate responsibilities, as it's one of the first countries to declare a climate emergency and set an ambitious 2045 net zero target. We've already achieved the largest reduction in emissions of any nation in the UK, and statistics show that we're halfway to net zero and decarbonising faster than the EU27 average. Electricity supply emissions have fallen by 88.1%, industrial emissions by 56.8%, and waste management emissions by 75.4% on the baseline. And Scotland has also created 63% of new woodland in the UK between 2022-2023, more than all the other UK nations combined. So while both Labour and the Tories are backtracking on serious climate policy and investment, jeopardising the just transition and the race to net zero, the Scottish Government is attracting international investment to grow the green economy and create skilled jobs. And two examples that the Minister referred to in her opening comments earlier on were regarding to Sumitomo to serve the offshore wind sector, creating around 330 jobs and bring £350 million of inward investment to Scotland, and also Haventus to regenerate Ardersier Port, which has the potential to create 3,000 jobs and reskilling opportunities. Now, these demonstrate the SNP government's ambition for Scotland's green economy, and in my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency, I joined the local bus company McGill's to celebrate their milestone of reaching 10 million zero emission miles. Now, thanks to the continual investment by McGill's, their net zero fleet has now grown to over 110 electric buses, which have prevented 11,270 tonnes of carbon dioxide from entering the atmosphere. Sure.
The boy up briefly.
There is some fantastic work being done by bus companies. Lothian Buses in Edinburgh is doing similar work, but the key issue is we simply don't have enough bus services for people to use, and we've lost hundreds, and we're not seeing the work done in the 2019 Transport Act that would have improved the number of bus services we could have across the country.
McMillan.
I'm just about to come on to that particular point in terms of bus services, because this is where planning is really important. So the reduction, going back to the McGill's point, the reduction is equivalent to planting around 1.3 million trees across an area the size of 2,784 football pitches. Now, the Tories are treating net zero as a burden. Also, we know that Chris Skidmore, the former Energy Minister, is planning to actually vote against the Tories next week due to their abandoning of climate pledges and the dismissal of the economic opportunities of net zero. And Labour have abandoned a £28 billion green investment pledge. And this damaging decision to cut energy investment will destroy Scottish jobs and harm economic growth. Now, but, Presiding Officer, now, going on to the point about planning. Now, Transport Scotland briefing, which Monica Lennon actually touched upon, is actually very helpful. I'm going to quote one part from it, and that is that to reduce transport emissions, we must see a modal shift away from private car use. This is where planning is hugely important. So local authorities and the planning authorities, when it comes to housing applications, they need to fully consider those applications, including Inverclyde Council and the redevelopment of the former Inverkip power station site, which, sadly, if that goes ahead, that will rely solely on private car use. There will be no buses, there's no access to trains, only private car use, and that will destroy the economy in the western part of Inverclyde. So, Presiding Officer, I'm not going to stand here and take lessons from Labour and the Tories when it comes to climate. I truly believe Scotland could make an even greater contribution to global climate action if we were not reliant upon decisions made elsewhere. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to advise the Chamber, what time we had in hand has pretty much been exhausted, so members will have to stick now to their time limit allocation. I call Edward Mountain to be followed by John Mason. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I wonder why you made that announcement just before I started speaking. I'm delighted to be speaking this afternoon on the climate change crisis that we face. And I don't want to spend my time this afternoon blaming everyone else. I want to identify some of the problems that I see that face us in reaching our net zero target in 2045. As we rely on increasing amounts of electrification across Scotland, but not only from offshore and onshore wind, there are various things that we have to come to terms with, one of which is the increased amount of power lines and battery stations that we'll need to see across Scotland. It was only the other day I was speaking to SSEN about what is actually required. And of course, they don't tell us because they work to a 10-year plan and then don't make it clear what's required in local communities. But their answer was the Beauly to Denny power line, which we see stretching through the middle of the Cairngorms National Park, will not be in 2045 one power line, but it'll be four. And that's a major problem in remote rural areas around Scotland where they have no power lines, and they might be facing one or two power lines coming down the track towards them. Now, there's only a certain amount of community benefit that communities will accept. There's only a certain amount of village halls that can be built as a result of the benefit that can be given from wind farms and also from electric companies. What we need to see is a bit more honesty, I believe, from some of these transmission companies. My email box is full of emails from people across the Highlands complaining about the arrogance of SSEN, who turn up demanding that power lines will be put in, not being clear. And I believe the government has a role in striking the balance of achieving net zero and getting SSEN, I will in a minute, to get SSEN to speak more constructively to communities. I'll give way
briefly, Minister.
I'm really glad that Mr Mountain's raised this. Will he support me in my calls that I've been making over the last year to ensure that both community engagement and community benefit are not just made mandatory by the UK Government, but also that there is a codes of practice associated with both of those things?
Edward Mountain.
I don't think it's necessary for the UK government to step in and do this. SSEN is a big... Sorry, you asked for an answer, so don't barrack me from the sedentary position. Let me answer, please, Minister. So, I don't believe it's up to the UK government. I believe SSEN should be stepping up to the plate and dealing with communities properly. Turning to other ways of dealing with our problem, we could be using more electricity than we are at the moment by using hydrogen. Those times that we're generating power and it's not being used, hydrogen is a very good way of storing that power. And I accept that the UK government has a role in this by maybe asking electricity companies to use 20%, say, of their electricity generated from hydrogen. And we could be using more of hydro-treated vegetable oil to allow vehicles to run on non-fossil fuels and older cars to be allowed into low emission zones. Now, I want to just ask and pose the question. I support the Electric Vehicle Infrastructure Fund that was announced last year by the government. It's got to deliver by 2026 more charging points. Now, they'll say we have more charging points per head than anywhere else in the UK. It doesn't make any difference if there isn't one in your locality. So there was £30 million promised by the government, and they were to generate £30 million from private investment. I haven't seen the £30 million from the government, and I've heard no news of £30 million from private investment. Perhaps when the minister sums up, we could have some indication of that. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Mountain. And I now call the final speaker in the open debate, John Mason, up to 4 minutes. Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. Firstly, I think we can be positive about a lot that has already happened. We have seen a tremendous growth in wind power and other forms of renewable electricity generation. I understand that electricity supply emissions have fallen by 88%, industrial emissions by 56%, and waste management emissions by 75%. However, we all accept that we have further to go. Transform Scotland point out in their briefing that transport is the largest source of climate emissions in Scotland. And I have to say that was probably not helped by all the fans going to the Euros. But it is a little simplistic to say that this is a devolved area and Scotland can boost public transport and take similar measures all by itself. The Scottish Fiscal Commission, in their report in March this year, Fiscal Sustainability Perspectives Climate Change, emphasised the interrelationship between the UK and Scottish Government actions. Concerning surface transport, they point out that while Scotland controls most public spending, many aspects of regulation are reserved, including banning polluting vehicles or imposing more stringent emission standards. In addition, Scottish funding is very much linked to Westminster, whether it be our resource funding, which largely comes from the block grant, or the capital funding, which has lately been cut, if it's very short.
Patrick Harvey, please.
The member is right about some of those restrictions, but it is a matter of fact that for many years, Scottish governments successively have prioritised building high-carbon infrastructure, road building, instead of investing in low-carbon infrastructure.
John Mason.
I'll take that as a statement and just leave that in the air. So, Scotland is dependent to a large extent on the UK. No, I'm sorry, I don't have time. Or Mr MacArthur is going to get me. So Scotland is dependent to a large extent on the UK, especially in relation to funding, while the UK is also dependent on Scotland to meet its targets, not least because we have so much more land per head of population. We have 32% of the UK landmass, roughly half of the trees, and 70% of the peatland. The Climate Change Committee estimates that 30% of UK-wide costs associated with land use change and forestry are assigned to Scotland. So the UK insisting strictly on the Barnett formula for funding required to reach net zero is not going to cut it for either Scotland or the UK. Can I just make a few comments on the Conservative amendment? They have picked up the phrase anti-science, which I think came from Tom Greatrex of the Nuclear Industry Association and former Labour MP. But this really is a nonsense phrase in this context. Science is very good at telling us how nuclear power works, and even how nuclear weapons work for that matter. And in passing, we might note that science has not thus far told us what to do with the nuclear waste. However, science cannot possibly tell us if nuclear power is a good thing or a bad thing. That is not science's job, and in fact, science is totally unable to make that distinction. It is human beings who have to weigh up the evidence from science, the evidence concerning the economics, and the evidence concerning the environment. Absolutely, we should all be considering the science on a whole range of questions we face. But at the end of the day, it is human beings who have to make the moral judgment as to what is right and wise way to go. And that is beyond the scope of science, or AI for that matter. In the interest of balance, I would just pick up a phrase in the Green Amendment: fossil fuel companies are the godfathers of climate chaos. I think that is slightly overstating the case. Fossil fuels have been a tremendous boon to our society, and we have all gained from progress made through the Industrial Revolution and since then. However, just as we moved from coal to oil and gas, we are now moving away to cleaner, renewable energy. I think we are all broadly agreed that that is the right way to go. However, where we probably do disagree a bit is on how fast we can and should make that move. We certainly need to get the balance right on the speed of that move. So in conclusion, we are all agreed on the need to tackle climate change. I think we are all committed to reaching net zero, so we should all be able to support the government motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. We now move to closing speeches, and I call first Mark Ruskell, up to 4 minutes, Mr Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also join members in wishing best wishes to the Cabinet Secretary, and I'm looking forward to working with Dr Allen in the months ahead as well. Now, the Minister at the beginning of the debate asked us to recommit to the climate emergency and a declaration of climate emergency And I'm happy to do that. And I'm happy to celebrate, of course, the work that was done under the Sturgeon era on climate justice, particularly the whole debate about loss and damage at COP26 and the commitments that were made there. But I think what the Minister also has to acknowledge is that the debt that we owe, the debt that Scotland owes countries that are not responsible for climate change but are now bearing the brunt of this crisis, is now spiralling out of control. It is many orders of magnitude beyond what the Scottish Government put on the table for a loss and damage fund at COP26. And that should inspire us to take more meaningful action to reduce our emissions and to meet our global obligations. So the Minister then went on to challenge the Chamber to back action. And I absolutely agree on that. But I also ask the Scottish Government to reflect on how we've got to the point where that 75% target has had to be dropped. In 2020, as Sarah Boyack mentioned, the UK CCC did write to the Scottish Government and it identified a whole range of areas which the Government had to move on then, not now, but then, in order to get anywhere close to that target. And one of those was, of course, about heat pumps, which the Government is within devolved responsibilities and the Government could have acted on then. The reality is that that climate plan that came on the back of the target was not fit for purpose. Numerous parliamentary committees told the Government it was not fit for purpose, but the Government didn't make the necessary changes that were needed. So I just hope that this Government recognises and learns from that experience. Now, the Minister then went on to mention about the UK Government and about the cut in capital infrastructure funds, and she's absolutely right, it has been devastating. So when we talk about, you know, the interests around this chamber, solar panels, Sarah Boyack, tree planting, Edward Mountain, bus infrastructure, Alec Rowley, EV charging points, Douglas Lumsden, this all requires capital infrastructure. It all requires us to build our way out of climate change with important infrastructure that's needed. I think I'm a bit short of time. Am I a bit shorter?
If it's a brief intervention.
Brief intervention.
It's a brief intervention. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Just following on from that, I wanted to bring out to the Chambers today, in reference to the Fiscal Sustainability Report, that without mitigation, debt to GDP ratio in the UK is about 98% to GDP. Without mitigation, it'd be 289%. And that reflected, it seems utterly astounding that the Scottish Government's had a 20% cut in capex over the next 5 years when you're looking at those kind of figures.
Mark Ruskin.
Well, I think that point, yeah, stands up absolutely, and it reinforces what I'm saying. And I think the question here is for a new Labour government. I mean, we will be backing the Labour amendment in this debate, but if Labour cuts its commitment for £28 billion back to £5 billion, that would leave us in a poor state. And I think, as Greenpeace have said, reflecting on Labour's manifesto, you know, you can't deliver real change with spare change. Yeah. So we absolutely need infrastructure. And I know the Tories don't always like infrastructures. They don't like transmission lines. They don't like wind farms. They love nuclear. But Mr. Lumsden can't say whether he would love nuclear if it was in his backyard or not. So, you know, we need to get serious about what's actually needed here. And I think Patrick Harvey summed it up well when he talked about the climate bill that's coming being a pivotal moment where we need to take those bold policy choices. And I would ask this government to double down on what we were starting to achieve collectively through the Bute House Agreement and not roll back on the initiatives that were started, particularly to resist pressure perhaps within the government's own party, perhaps within those who are not speaking in this debate this afternoon who want to see certain policies rolled back. So when it comes to heat and buildings, absolutely we're on the right track with that. It's a template for the rest of the UK. We should be doubling down on the work of Patrick Harvey and government and delivering that, just as we're going to be doubling down this afternoon on the work of Lorna Slater with a circular economy bill. When it comes to the onshore wind sector deal, the vehicle mileage reduction plan, we need to be raising revenue to reinvest back in public transport so that we can deliver safer communities. We need to see this government raise its ambition. We need to see climate co-benefits, as Ben McPherson spelled out in his speech, delivered alongside climate change. So making people's lives easier, not harder, in tackling this crisis. That's what this government needs to do. It needs to double down, and we'll be backing those actions and those policies in this chamber.
Thank you. I now call Alec Rowley. Around 5 minutes, Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would also want to, on behalf of Labour in closing, wish the Cabinet Secretary the very best for a maternity leave. Both the Labour speakers, Sarah Boyack and Monica Lennon, made the point that if we are serious about tackling the climate emergency, then we need to begin by working together across this Parliament. But sadly, even from today's speeches, that has not been the case. Labour were last in power at a UK level in 2010. They were last in power in here in 2007, and yet we've had a number of SNP speakers today somehow attack Labour for the failures of the Scottish Government to reach its targets. And that really signifies for me the problem in this Parliament, where those who first created this Parliament envisaged a Parliament, even by the way it's laid out, where politicians would come together, would work together. Now, it may be that there's an election next week, but it is typical of the type of debates that we have in this Parliament, and it's no wonder that the people of Scotland actually are quite fed up of it and often ask questions about what we do achieve. And there has been many achievements, I would have to say. I agreed with Maurice Golden, where he talked about the damage to public trust, where there's an inability to acknowledge the shortcomings of certain policies, and we have to be able to do that. Many people in here have talked about, or a few today have talked about, transport. I made the point a few weeks ago when the Cabinet Secretary made her statement about reductions or the fact that we seem to be dumping the targets. I made a couple of points. Firstly, when Stuart McMillan talks earlier about the early successes, one of the biggest reasons that we had those early successes was more to do with Scottish Power than it was to do with the Scottish Government, and that was when they decided to close Longannet. And overnight, we had a massive reduction in the emissions that came from that. And there has been very little progress actually coming after that, and that's where we need to make progress. But as I think Mark Ruskell said, the transport is the largest source of climate emissions in Scotland, 36%. But the failure of joined-up government, which I level at this government, I think in a fair way, the failure to join-up government actually is, for me, one of the major issues. So the government say they'll cut car kilometres by 20%, and that was a target. I'm sure that target might no longer stay, given the record. But the fact is, then, you look at the policies around that, and there's no joined-up thinking, no joined-up strategy. So you have the bus partnership fund that comes forward, something that was welcomed, because what we do know is if we're serious about getting people to leave their cars at home, then public transport has to be affordable, accessible and reliable. And I hear what I think Patrick Harvey said earlier and John Mason about capital and cuts to capital investment. But if you look at Greater Manchester and look at the achievements that they've done there, because they have gone for bus franchising, so giving control over buses back to public organisations that can then set out and the bus routes that will be taken, the bus routes that will be taken, so that bus companies in Greater Manchester bid for a collective of routes, whereas in Scotland, and we saw it in West Lothian with the company that was mentioned earlier, when they think there's not enough profit in it, they simply pull their bus routes. And that becomes part of the problem. The Cabinet Secretary, I think, was critical earlier of Labour, where Labour does not support the workplace parking levy. The reason we don't support the workplace parking levy is we think it's ill thought through, ill considered, and we actually think it would put people out of work. I don't know if ministers and other members in here have ever actually tried using public transport, but I know that I have constituents that talk to me regularly who have been offered jobs and were not able to take those jobs because the public transport could not get them there. And then they're then threatened with benefits, etc. So, as I say, we have to be more imaginative than the Scottish Government have been. We need to look at peak fares and continue it. That was a good move. But we also need to look at flat fares, because for a lot of people, they actually can't afford to use the buses. So in summing up, you know, let's dump all this constant barrage of fighting in this chamber and find ways to work together, rather than always trying to score political points. As we've seen, I have to say, from the SNP today, it's not good enough and it lets the people of Scotland down.
Thank you. I now call on Graeme Simpson. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Simpson.
Thank you very much. I'd also like to wish Marion McCallum the very best of luck as she leaves to have a baby, and look forward to working with the other ministers in their new roles. Now, Alec Rowley calls for us all to work together, and I agree with him. I think we should work together because there's actually a lot of consensus on this issue. But in order to agree on that, we have to agree what the problem is. And this government has tried to tell us that tackling the climate emergency is one of its top priorities. Well, really, you could have fooled me. Yep. And certainly yesterday, when Parliament rejected, or would have rejected, a series of amendments to the Circular Economy Bill that would have seen real change in the way we deal with goods and waste, yeah, then that does not show that we're serious about this. And just last week, we heard from the Scottish Government in its own report that it's yet again missed its own legally binding targets for greenhouse gas emission reductions. And that failure is not a one-off. It's part of a pattern that's lasted for the past decade. And Maurice Golden listed a number of failures, so he's saving me from doing the same. How can this Parliament, or indeed the Scottish public, believe that this government is prioritising the climate emergency when it's missed 9 of its last 13 climate targets, as a number of speakers have pointed out? Not only that, but in an admission of that failure, the SNP government scrapped their own target of reducing emissions by 75% by 2030 just months ago. When Nicola Sturgeon announced Scotland's climate change targets in 2019, she boasted that Scotland had the most stretching targets in the world. They were, and they proved too stretching for the SNP government. Domestic transport accounts for the largest share of greenhouse gas emissions in Scotland at 28.3% in 2022. That's up from 26.2% the year before. Emissions from international shipping and aviation have almost doubled in the past year. Those figures are heading in the wrong direction. The answer to transport emissions from the Greens is to tax motorists even more through nasty road charging schemes. And we've yet to hear what the SNP has in store for us, perhaps because they fear a voter backlash. Where is that plan to cut car miles? We've yet to see it. We don't even know when we're going to see it. Now, the SNP government are always quick to blame Westminster for anything. They say the Scottish Parliament lacks responsibility for energy and they need more capital investment to deliver net zero. Back in September, Humza Yousaf called Westminster's rolling back on their climate pledges unforgivable and vowed that Scotland would, quote, continue to show global leadership. Global leadership in the face of the climate crisis. Well, we've yet to see that. And I have to say that pointing the finger of blame south of the border is not going to save the planet. I will.
Cabinet Secretary.
In what way does decarbonising faster than the rest of the UK and faster than the EU27 not demonstrate global leadership on emissions reduction?
Graeme Simpson.
Well, in what way does missing 9 of the last 13 targets demonstrate that? It doesn't demonstrate that at all. We need to get real. Scotland's record is not good here. We need plans, pragmatic plans, that bring people with us on the journey to net zero. As Douglas Lumsden said, his speech was all about plans. We don't have them from this government. Now, the Climate Change Committee's damning report was published in March. It should have been a wake-up call for the Scottish Government. This found that the Scottish Government had failed to achieve its ambitious climate goals yet again, that the publication of the draft climate change plan had been delayed yet again, and most key indicators of delivery progress were off track yet again. And most concerning of all, the committee said that there's no comprehensive delivery strategy from the Scottish Government. No wonder their actions continue to fall short of their own legal requirements. Now, I mentioned transport. I'm very keen to know when we might see a route map for the government's plan to deliver 24,000 EV charge points by 2030. I'd also like to know when we're going to see an integrated ticketing system for our public transport network to get more people using it, get more people using public transport. We've been promised that for well over a decade. No sign of it. Our amendment also calls on the Scottish Government to reverse its anti-science approach to new nuclear technology. When I asked the Scottish, I have no time, I'm afraid. When I asked the First Minister about this last week, he told me the government doesn't support new nuclear power stations because they're more expensive. What he failed to mention is that renewable energy is far less reliable than nuclear, with wind only available 45% of the time and requiring backup from gas. Now that the annual targets have been scrapped, these sort of debates, presiding officer, will become less frequent, but I sincerely hope we'll not be back in this position in 2045. Well, you and I won't be. If tackling the climate emergency is really a priority for this government, it needs to take responsibility and take action.
Thank you, Mr Simpson. I'll check my diary for 2045. Can I join other members in wishing the Cabinet Secretary all the best for her maternity leave, but also invite her in the meantime to wind up the debate a generous 8 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and to all members who have passed on their kind wishes. I'm really pleased to close this debate, which is the fourth in the government series exploring the First Minister's top priorities for the government he leads. As Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy for one more day, I am delighted that the First Minister has placed the climate and nature emergencies among his top priorities, alongside growing our economy, delivering excellent public services, and eradicating child poverty. And during the time that I have worked on this matter in a number of different roles, I have had the privilege of seeing ministers, government officials, parliamentarians from across this chamber, communities, organisations and businesses alike work exceptionally hard to rise to the challenge before us. And it is a significant challenge. Like every country who is dedicated to this journey, we are naturally grappling with its scale and complexity. And as such, the work that we've undertaken has been actively iterative. Scotland has both led the way and we have learned as we've gone along. And in that time, we have achieved so much that I am proud of, and I'm pleased that members across the chamber have been able to highlight some of those successes today. My colleague Gillian Martin kicked us off in that regard, but Rona Mackay was absolutely right to highlight the transition that Scotland is on to becoming a renewables powerhouse, whilst at the same time platforming the unacceptable situation of transmission charges that we continue to face. I'm also really pleased that my colleague Ben McPherson raised the very important link between air pollution and ill health, something that I'm very passionate about solving. I'm pleased that he spoke of the development of the four low emission zones in that regard. And I'd add to that how pleased I am that in the last number of years, we have seen all of the air quality monitoring sites in Scotland meeting their objectives for the first time outside of a lockdown period. This is undoubtedly having an impact on Scotland's public health, and I welcome it strongly. I'm grateful to Mark Ruskell for highlighting the work that we achieved together in government, and I look forward to continuing to work with him and his colleagues as we take forward a number of those areas. But the emissions reduction impact of much of what we have done in the last 5 years will not be felt until the future. And this is particularly the case for our natural environment and in the energy transition. But we have to act now to see results in future years. And the government is continuing to do this on an ongoing basis. And I often talk of our acceptance that we must continually challenge ourselves in that regard. Now, I agree with Alec Rowley entirely on the need for consensus, and I commit myself to it in this chamber and with an incoming UK government. But I do have to put on record my regret from my experience in this role of how occasionally Scotland's opposition parties appear unable to recognise our nation's successes, even as they rightly hold the government to account. For example, I will always celebrate our success, whilst I'm always clear that more needs to be done. But Douglas Lumsden and Maurice Golden's contributions were just relentlessly negative. And doing that without seeming to accept how their own party's record has been about, I will in a moment, has been about standing in the way of even modest measures in the Scottish Parliament. And indeed, they have a horrendous record in the UK government, which is contributing, I think, to their electoral success utterly falling through the floor. And I'll take Maurice Golden.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention. Just to quote from my earlier remark, let me start by welcoming the news last week that Scotland's emissions are now more than 50% below their 1990 level. Is that relentlessly negative?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, it's not, and I'm grateful to him for putting it on the record in the first place and for repeating it now. Perhaps another example of this, however, is Sarah Boyack, who I know cares deeply about this issue and has been working on it for a number of years. And she was right to talk about buildings decarbonisation and the importance of it. However, she did that without speaking to, for example, our Heat and Buildings report for 22-23, which highlights how through £170 million of investment, we've helped 138,000 households through the Home Energy Scotland Advice Service, made over 8,000 fuel-poor households warmer and easier to heat, and we've installed over 5,000 zero-direct emissions heating systems. And we didn't also talk about the new build heat standard, something which my colleagues in the Greens introduced when they were in government, which is a demonstrably positive move in the decarbonisation of buildings in Scotland. Yes, I will briefly. Thank you.
Sarah Boyack.
Part of the point of being in opposition is to push to go further and harder, and that's why we do that. If I was using my space now, I'd talk about heat networks, where we've got huge opportunities in Scotland. Midlothian Council's doing a heat network with Vattenfall. Big opportunities, renewables, and that would also reduce people's bills, and we can do it in our big cities and our towns and get going on it. So it's about doing more and doing it fast.
Cabinet Secretary.
I understand that, and I share Sarah Boyack's desire for all of us to work together to do more and to do it faster. But my point is this. This progress didn't emerge because we wished it to. It happened because of strong political leadership, careful policy development and the prioritisation of scarce public money, and a truly cross-societal effort which this government redoubles its, and restates its commitment to today. And of course, I just want to take this opportunity again to highlight that and to thank all of those who have contributed to the progress to date. Earlier in a debate we had in the Scottish Parliament, the Conservatives used their motion, used this precious time that they have in our national parliament, to criticise those who are campaigning for climate action. And I just want to say how distasteful and wrong I think that is, to criticise those who have peacefully but bravely raised their voice in the name of action, calling for ambition from governments, including my own. And of course, climate activists, they act for our future here in Scotland and the UK, because they know, as this government does, that communities around the world are truly on the front line of climate change, losing everything up to and including their lives. And my colleague Gillian Martin spoke of much of the work that the SNP has done in recent years to support campaigners in the Global South. The people that I have met on this journey, the climate activists, they do this, frankly, because they have to. Many have seen utter devastation in their countries and have been forced to act, like Brenda Mwale from Malawi, Ineza Grace from Rwanda, and Salote Soku from the Pacific, who I've worked with. Also my friend Elizabeth Watuti, Kenyan environment and climate activist, and an incredible woman. Also the women who I won't name, but who I've worked with on our Human Rights Defenders programme, who've risked so much to lead the way on gender and environment. Presiding Officer, as a politician, you're often asked who your heroes are. Well, these activists, these women are my heroes. And all of this work in Scotland and internationally is precisely because we fulsomely accept climate science and expert advice, which tells us that the impacts of human-caused climate change will continue to intensify. Do I have any time?
Cabinet Secretary must conclude.
Okay. Presiding Officer, that's deliberately why we've framed our motion today on climate science, on independent advice, and I ask all members across the chamber to support us in that. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, being very conscious of time, I am very pleased to close today's debate. It's apt that it should be the last that I take in government before my own maternity leave, but whether it's our own children, those around the world, generations to come, we owe it to them all to stand against climate wars and climate denial, and to stand for action which is capable of rising to the emergency before us. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scottish Government priorities tackling the climate emergency. It is now time to move on to the next item of business.